Now we hear from Senate President Russell Pearce. Thank you for joining us tonight on Horizon. Good to have you here.
Hey, thanks for having me. Thank you.
Let's start with, why do you think you are facing a recall? Why do you think this is happening?
Well, you know, it is pretty clear, I think. It started a year before I was even elected. It's about SB 1070 more than anything else. The guy that started this is a Berkeley-trained community organizer, not in my district, who started protests a year before I was elected for this term. And he's the same guy that brought groups down to the Capitol, threw the American flag on the ground, trampled it, had children were trampling it. This is a really ugly group of people, you know, that started this recall.
So when you were quoted as saying you think outsiders have hijacked the will of Mesa voters, you still believe that?
Well, let me tell you, and let's qualify that term. What's happened is this is an outside group of liberals in a district that's elected a Republican, and they come through the back door refusing to go through the process that our founders set up, and that's a primary where your party nominates you. See, this is a Republican that is endorsed by the Democrats. He's endorsed by the left. And to me, I mean, pretty sad when you come through the back door, refuse to do the primary process. We have an election every 2 years. And that's a good process. And I believe the short terms. I want a short leash on you. I want to remember what you've done good, and I want to remember if you've not kept those promises. And that's why we have an election every 2 years. This recall is an abuse of the process. It's for keeping my promises, not for doing anything wrong. It's for keeping my promises and being successful. 34 states are modeling Arizona. Governor just called me. She's been around the country. Everywhere she goes, standing ovations. America is proud of Arizona, but apparently these folks aren't.
To that end, your opponent says he doesn't seem to have all that much difference in terms of policy on a variety of issues, and I want to get to some of those issues in a second.
Sure.
He says it's tone. It's simply that the nature of the tone. It's bad for Mesa. It's bad for Arizona. How do you respond?
Let's talk about tone. I have a letter by all the legislators, but a couple Republican senators, that talk about me being one of the best leaders, most efficient, effective, and good to work with. Kirsten Sinema, and to give her a little credit, because she's probably as far left as you can get in our caucus, but we get along well. And she stopped Channel 12 on a debate that they were saying the same kind of thing. She had said, simply not true. I love President Pearce. He is fair, and he helps anybody get their bills heard if they're responsible. So simply not true. Talk about tone, and let's turn the tables a little bit. In a debate, Mr. Lewis calls Arizona racist, calls Mesa racist, compares us to 1964 Alabama.
Stop right
there,
though.
That's the tone he wants?
Stop right there, though. He says he didn't compare Arizona to 1964 Alabama. He has heard others.
No, that's
compare.
Not true. He had a chance to recant it. I was right there when the media said, do you mean that? And he said yes.
So you're saying he said it?
He said it. I was there. Go get the tapes.
Okay, I want to make sure we're clear on it, because
he said he was transmitting
information.
He said he's embarrassed for Arizona and Mesa on the image, and he compared it to 1964 Alabama. How embarrassing can that be?
Back to the original question. Do you think Mesa voters want a change in tone from their representative?
No. They've elected me 16 times, counting primaries and generals. They've supported me. I've always kept my promise. I've kept every promise I've ever made. We've been successful. I vote 100% pro-life. I've led the charge to protect property rights from the abuse of government eminent domain. I was a prime sponsor of the marriage amendment to protect marriage between a man and a woman. I wrote the legislation and put it on the ballot, passed overwhelmingly by voters to eliminate affirmative action. I put four ballot propositions on in 06 that passed by 75% of Arizonans.
And yet, these outsiders, as you call them, were able to get enough signatures for really an unprecedented recall election. How do you explain that?
Money. You know, and even the guy who had that, Randy Perez, admitted almost everybody they contacted didn't know anything about Russell Pearce. That was his own statement that we have. So these were folks, again, that they had paid signature gatherers go for months to get signatures.
Let's touch on some issues here. You've mentioned SB 1070. Passing that law, getting the notoriety of passing that law and pushing that law, was that good for Mesa? Was that good for Arizona?
It's good for everybody. Again, 34 states writing legislation modeled. 34 states writing legislation modeled after SB 1070. Let me tell you the statement I just have from Phoenix PD, Phoenix Law Enforcement Association. They just gave me a statement. They have a 30-year low in crime, a 30-year low in crime, and they have 600 police vacancies, and they attribute it all to 1070. It goes on, but they attribute the safest streets they've had in over 30 years to SB 1070.
Did Mesa voters?
That's law enforcement.
Did Mesa voters put you into office, though, to pass laws, this one and others, that constantly bring up court fights regarding preemption?
Of course they did. It's about states' rights. And let me tell you, in preemption, that's a wonderful argument. You know, the Supreme Court just passed, just gave us a 5-3 decision on employer sanctions. That was the same arguments about that preemption. There's never been a preemption. This is another myth that they love to play on. States have inherent police powers under the Constitution to enforce these laws. There has never been a preemption. It's been a lack of political will. The only impediment to enforcing these laws has been local.
Okay.
The lack of politicians and local police chiefs to do their job.
All right. I want to keep it moving here because there's a lot of issues to cover.
Right.
Education, $230-some-odd million cut to education. Is that good for Mesa? Is that good for Arizona?
Well, when you've got a deficit that we had, education is half the budget. We've cut government 15%. We have 15% fewer employees in government today. We only cut education 1.5%. We have always protected education, and we lead the nation in school choice. We advocate. In fact, I'm working with the governor and John Hoopenthal, superintendent of public instruction, to create pay for performance. So we start rewarding teachers and principals who achieve high academic success in the classroom. So we've got a lot of things we're going to do to even make education better for those who perform.
Is there more room to cut education funding? State funding education.
It's not a matter of more room. I mean, there's never a government that can't afford to be more efficient, more effective. And we know that. But we support education. We protected education. We will continue to protect education. I have children in school. I have grandchildren in school. All my kids went to private in public school. Good grief, we're pro education.
All right. What about access state Medicaid program as far as freezing the eligibility, cutting folks from those roles? Is that good for Mesa? Is that good for Arizona?
It's good for Arizona. We're the fifth most richest access program in the nation. One out of five Arizonans are on access. You can't sustain that kind of abuse. It is just out of control. So we made modest arrangements, you know, and we still are one of the richest programs in America. We're way above federal standards and federal requirements, the Medicaid requirements. So you betcha. What we're trying to do is bring back accountability, some co-pays, you don't show up for an appointment, but there's a cost. The taxpayers pay for all this. So we're just trying to put some responsibility and accountability and transparency back into the system you and I pay for that has been overly abused and used.
You got cuts to access, you got cuts to education. Something specific to Mesa.
Again, in 31 and 16, and the governor signed those. Russell Pearce didn't do this budget.
Yeah, he
it's
didn't
a
do
collaboration
you,
of getting you, a budget
but
out.
But you are a big proponent of
yes.
these things. You helped push these
yes,
things through.
Yes, because we're going to balance the budget. The first time in years that Arizona passed out a constitutionally balanced budget. We're proud of that.
Some
that
say that there were gimmicks
lifting.
Involved, though. Some were saying that there were gimmicks in there.
No, there weren't. And that's another fabrication. No gimmicks, no bonding. No borrowing.
All right.
We have additional debt to pay up. We pay $325 million a year just on the cost of debt in Arizona. We're going to have to pay that debt down.
Mayor of Mesa, among many local municipal leaders, saying that the state legislature, you and you, the people that you lead there at the Capitol, are meddling in municipal affairs, and to knock it off, let the cities take care of themselves. And you guys should, of all the people regarding states' rights, you should understand that the city would know best on how to manage
maybe
finances.
Maybe you've got to go read the Constitution. These are political subdivisions. We meddle all the time. The state, any power and authority the counties and cities have is delegated. Unlike the states, which is inherent, we created the federal government, limited the federal government in Articles 1, 2, and 3 to their limited and enumerated powers. The states, the power all resides with the states. The states created the cities and the counties. They are political subdivisions. The title alone ought to give them some clue.
But when
we
but,
only meddle when it's appropriate, when things are out of abuse. We believe in local
but
government.
But when so many municipal leaders, including the mayor of Mesa, and you're running in that district over there, you got folks along the country.
My endorsement.
Well,
I
understand that may be. But he's saying that this is too far. This has gone too far as far as the state legislature getting involved.
We disagree. What has happened is they had gone too far. Many of the cities. Mesa actually been one of the better on not going too far. But the city's gone too far, like on impact fees. You know, if you want to grow the economy, and people have the right to have a dream, and that's buying their own home. When you have impact fees that reach $20,000 and $25,000 on top of other permits and fees, it's gone too far. The affordability of a house is out of control. All we did is rein that in, create transparency, accountability, and make sure the impact fees go to the impact that they're alleging they go for. Now, okay. Is that going too far? Absolutely not. It's protecting the taxpayer from runaway backdoor taxes.
All right, we're running out of time here, so I guess more things I need to cover. I want your thoughts on the Olivia Cortez controversy.
You know, it's kind of interesting they keep using this as a controversy. First of all, I don't know Olivia. I've never met Olivia. I didn't get her in the race. I didn't get her out of the race. Not at all. I've never met her today.
Were you involved in any part of her candidacy?
No, I'm going to say it again. I don't know her. I've never talked to her. I've never been engaged in any of it. Everybody knows that. I've got a couple of family members that collect signatures, and they do it for people all the time because they have a right on the ballot. Let's talk about a sham candidate, you know, and that is you got people outside of our district that bring in a candidate, you know, Jerry Lewis. You got people inside of our district that bring forth a candidate, and they're the bad guy. She filed before Jerry Lewis. No, let me finish here because this is really important. You know, and what's really the sad case that nobody talks about, this lady was ran out. She was intimidated. They went to her, Jerry Lewis himself, trying to talk her out of the race, and then sued her. This is civil rights. Where's Gloria Allred when you need her? They violated this gal's rights by threatening and intimidating and making it an uncovered. She drops out of the race. Would have I had her in? No. Would I wish Jerry Lewis wasn't in? Absolutely. But she had a right, is my point.
So critics will say that if you did not know this, and some folks either in your family or in your campaign were implicated, you should have known.
No, not necessarily. They probably didn't tell me at first. The point is, they did nothing wrong. Two of my nieces collected, and these are wonderful nieces. Let me share the story with them. I think it's important. One of them came over to my house the other night. Again, worried that she had hurt my campaign, because they have different last names. Never thought about it. Shed tears, sitting down in my office, talking to me, because she was so concerned about the damage that had been caused from an honest effort, did nothing wrong.
Okay.
Shame on the media for the way they've treated Olivia and this family who had right to gather signatures to put somebody on the ballot.
We've got about 20 seconds left. My last question, this entire experience, from everything we've talked about today, start to finish, has it humbled you? Will it change you if you are put back in office?
You know, I'd like to think that I'm always humble. I have a good heart, just like my grandchildren. I'm a tender-hearted guy when it comes to family, God, country. I'm not bashful about sharing my feelings and my love for this republic. I fight every day for freedom and less government and the taxpayer. I'm rated number one legislator for defense of taxpayers, number one legislator in defense of freedom. I love this country, and I would hope that I always stay humble about this. I have a very tender heart when it comes to family, community, and what's right.
Okay, we have to stop you right there. Thank you so much for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
That is it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thank you so much for joining us. You have a great evening.